with us this morning. Amen. We can do better than that. Amen. Because we're excited about what God is doing here in the world. But if you're watching, I'm sure like the rest of us, we can benefit from going into the presence of the Lord in prayer. Is there anybody who needs prayer this morning? I know I do. Amen. Well, let's lift up our voices unto the Lord our God. Father, we celebrate you this morning. We give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise. We're grateful this morning, Father, that we can come boldly to the throne of grace and obtain mercy and help to bear in our time of need. We don't take this time for granted. We don't become so familiar with God till we don't need you anymore. Lord, we need you this morning. We draw nigh to God. For your word says, if we draw nigh to God, you would in return draw nigh to us. We thank you for reminding us this morning that this is holy ground. We don't take it for granted. This is holy ground. You've given us an opportunity to enter into the gates with thanksgiving and enter into your courts with praise, to be thankful unto you and to bless your holy name. And so, God, for no other reason than to just say thank you. Just to 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 say thank you, God. Thank you that you kept us, Father God. Thank you that you kept us, Lord Jesus. We just want to say thank you. So, Father, we just give you glory this morning. We thank you that this time is covered. We thank you, Father God, that we dedicate this time back to God, that you will be exalted above measure, that, Father God, somebody would be saved, that somebody would say yes to your will and yes to your way. While we're in the midst of a celebration, we don't miss out on the fact that we're here to glorify your name. Now, Father, we thank you for the word that's going to come forth. We thank you for every person that's watching, whether live stream or in person, that they would leave this place better than what they came, that the yoke would be destroyed and the burden would be removed, and they would be free to make decisions that would glorify your name. Now, Holy Spirit of God, bless Pastor David, our man of God. Bless Apostle and Mom Deb for coming this morning. Our overseers for making the deposit into our lives. And we're expecting you like never before. We bring our future into the present. We call forth the manifestation of your glory into this set time. And now, Holy Spirit of God, release your people to worship you like never before. In Jesus' name, shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Give him the glory. Give him the honor. Give him the praise. Amen. Celebrate the Lord. This is what we're going to worship to God, says we're going to worship him forever. And so if you're this close to the altar, you might as well go ahead and celebrate Jesus. Amen. You can come to the front. You can worship him. Come to the minister right quick, because I'm going to celebrate God. You can release the people that come on in this time to see celebrate Jesus.
Young people, I need y'all to come right down here for the crusade.
Y'all gotta get y'all clap together. Let me help you get your clap together. before his presence with exceeding joy. I'm telling you, excited about God. Excited about God this morning. Because he alone is worthy.
Yeah.
We get to worship him. There's nobody stopping you from lifting your hands. There's nobody saying, be quiet. Turn down the music. I'm in a Zoom meeting. You can freely worship him. And I'm excited about it. So this morning, his presence, we brought him in with us, but we're going to just settle here and rest in the presence of the Lord. Anybody want to just come to the front and just lift up your hands to God? Glory to God. Praise the Lord Jesus. Yes, 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 yes. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Glory to God.
Thank you. Glory to God! Put pressure on his name. Come on.
God, we give you praise this morning. We're thankful unto you, and we bless your holy name today, God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Mills this morning. Amen. Welcome him this morning, oh God. Celebrate your Holy Spirit, God. You're worthy. You're worthy. Come on and give it up for a man, God. Glory to God. Happy 25th anniversary to Through the Word Church and to Dr. David T. Mills. Oh my God. I just want to worship.
Oh, it's all right to worship him. Can we give him another praise? He's been wonderful. He's been marvelous. He's been faithful. He's been sovereign. He's been perfect in the midst of a pandemic. In the midst of it, he's proven how powerful he is in spite of, instead of, and right in the face of. Come on, give him one more praise. Come on. We just give him glory and honor today. He alone is worthy. There's none like him. We come to celebrate who God is.
Hallelujah.
Who God is. He's well alive. He's immortal. He's the King. There's none like him. He's so worthy of our praise. I just come to bless him today and thank him so much. Through the word, I just want to say again, thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your commitment. Thank you for your service. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for your life. Thank you for your love. Be seated in his presence, amen. You want a celebration, thank God for you. And then I'm super excited. I'm super duper excited to be able to have a father in the ministry, a mother in the ministry, a pastor, a non-pastor in the ministry. Hallelujah. Let's celebrate them this morning. Let's really show them how much we love them. Amen. That's it. Remember 27 years ago in the parking lot, out of your mouth. You remember that? 27 years ago in a parking lot, Shiloh Baptist Church, I'll never forget it. I said, the Lord, I believe, has put something in our heart to birth. He said, the Lord is calling you to birth a church.
Yes.
25 years later, lies, love, family, Christian, Christianity, Delaware, Oklahoma, Florida, Africa, London, I mean all over the world. And we are humbled by what God has done and is doing. And we certainly believe the best is yet to come. I believe that. And then I'm blessed to do life with this incredible worshiper, leader, businesswoman, mother, wife, lover. I'm trying to tell you, girl, you're a bad somebody. You are a bad somebody. You are. I love you so much. I thank God for you. I was reading about you today. I saw you in Proverbs 19, I think it's like 15. It said this: houses and riches are from inheritance of a father, but a prudent wife.
Come on.
A prudent wife is from the Lord. I looked it up and said that's sagacious. I don't even know what that word means. I don't know what you mean. You're sagacious, son. It means intelligent, wealthy, fine, businesslike, strategic, wise, sagacious, son. You are your sagacious. Girl, you're a bad son of God. You're a bad girl. She's a bitch. I didn't even know it. Lord have mercy. Good, good, good move. All right.
Some people, and our heart goes out to watch them, and we have been praying 6 o'clock to 6:30 every single day, Sunday to Sunday. What I recognize to us, this time has blessed our lives, and there's no way we can act like we have not been blessed through this moment. My children were sitting around last night fellowshipping, and they were like, Mom, they saw somebody, family, down the street from our house. Her mother had COVID in 93. And her mother was in the hospital. In the moment, her two older sisters, this lady is 50, her two sisters got COVID. Her two sisters' husbands got COVID. All four of them died in the moment. But just there, she came up, she saw us outside yesterday, two doors away from us, our neighbor. And she said, Bernadette, my husband's about to take me for a ride just to give me a moment to get some air.
Yes.
She said, my mother went in the hospital. My two sisters got COVID and both of their husbands. And I'm telling you, they're not here today. And I'm the one who has to tell my mom that hurt. I'm telling you, I don't need nobody else shouting with me.
No.
I brought my own Passover.
I said, matter of fact, Pastor Burley remember too. She every now and then we laugh about it. my first car, I had to tie ropes to the sunroof and hold on to the door that got shut off.
Oh, Jesus. We got some cars.
Come on, fuck. So we can laugh, man. But you stood by. And you had faith for me even when the door fell off.
Come on.
You ain't gotta go all that. We live out of the music anymore, man. You can do all that. They understand. And so you can tell them all about that. Then we had to get rid of that car. Then we had to borrow my grandfather's pink car. Remember that pink car?
Yes, I do.
Oh, you can't forget the pink car. That was Barney Rubble, my Barney Rubble car. Some of us had cars that had no floorboards.
Come on.
And you can see. You can see the yellow line and the white line. That's why you drive. So when people look at me and say, that's why you got a Jag.
Come on, Pastor Dave. Come on.
That's right.
And if he can take you from Barney Rubble to a Jag,
come on.
He's a bad guy.
Amen.
I'm only using that to let you understand. 25 years later, I can say
straight.
That. Because it wasn't an instant. Graham ain't do this.
Come on.
Before there was a Facebook.
Come on.
It was just blood, sweat, and Jesus.
Well.
It was more Jesus than blood than anything else. But I thank God that this is probably one of the greatest seasons of our life.
Yes, God.
I think the people and the leaders of our church are some of the most incredible people we know. I want to do two things real quick, and one of them is this. Deacon Dave, you can come here for a minute. Can I have all the leaders of Through the Word please stand up? All of them. If you lead the ministry of Through the Word, please stand up. If you lead the ministry of Through the Word, then you please stand up. Can you give me a chance with that? Deacon Dave got the bag, y'all. Deacon Dave got the bag. Deacon Dave got the bag. He ain't playing. You open it for us, Pastor Byrne? That's the bag. That's from TD Bank. They gave us a bag. Can y'all come up front? If any leaders, can you come up front just for a second? We want to do something. We've been talking about the idea of what happens in ministry. And sometimes, I said this last week, but for us, anniversary is a dual thing. When we mean by that, what we simply mean is this, is that it's like a husband and wife, and they have an anniversary, it's both of their anniversary.
Amen.
They build the family. They build the home. They build the destiny. They build the project. They build the purpose. And I already know, they do this almost every year. They just continue to bless our lives and so on to us. But because this is the 25th year, we wanted to sow back into y'all.
Yes.
And in the midst of a pandemic, instead of giving y'all, you know, we was planning to give y'all like $25 for 25 years. That was going to be nice. But y'all pushed through a pandemic. So we just want to see you sow a seed of $50 in every one of y'all lives and just be a blessing to y'all. For being a blessing to us. Amen. I'm talking about 50 a couple. I'm talking about 50 a person. Amen. 50 a person. You have blessed us. You stood with us. You helped us minister. You cried with us. You held us. You held up people's lives in South Carolina. You held up people's lives. You prayed with people. You cared for people. You interceded over people's lives. When we couldn't get there, you could get there. When we couldn't go, you could go. When we couldn't pray, y'all prayed for people. When we couldn't reach people, you reached people. And so I believe that you've got to be a partaker of whatever we have. And so we love each and every one of you. I know this is just a seed from our heart to your heart. And then we also have a couple of people that we want to never forget. Matter of fact, one of them we need to shout for. Sister Kamika made it home Saturday. Life to your home. We love you, and yours is coming by Cash App. Praise God. Amen. Amen. And you got your brand new knee. You got your brand new knee put in. Amen. So I see you going back home with your wife. Amen.
Amen.
But every leader, can you through the word celebrate these incredible, phenomenal leaders of the world?
We appreciate you. We're always thinking about God, what can we say?
We know there's not enough words. We know there's not enough seed. We know there's not enough whatever. But God, show us what we can do. He says, do the part you know to do. And this is our heart just back to you. Just being able to say, we celebrate you this morning. Amen. Receive our heart back to you all. Celebrate the leaders of this. We also celebrate our children who are here this morning. Can they please stand?
Yeah.
Celebrate. I see Christian. Yeah. I see Destiny. Right behind the cameras. I see Noah and Gabrielle up top. And celebrate Micaiah at work. Amen. Thank God for the job. And we celebrate Jesus. Amen. We thank God for all of their contribution with the ministry and just in the midst of the pandemic. All of their skill sets, technology, pushing buttons, whatever, websites, whatever it is, we celebrate them this morning, and we thank God for their hearts for Jesus Christ, and we just bless God for this time. There are so many of you here we just want to say a special thank you to, but please know that in the sense of time, our heart is just to capitalize on what God wants to deposit in our lives. So thank each of you for your faithfulness on this morning as we prepare for Apostle Imam Day. We're excited to have Jaleel here with us this morning. And
I think Pastor Dave is with him too. Did I hear Pastor Dave?
Oh, I didn't see him.
I heard, you know what? Pastor Dave got this. He got this shout that you got to hear. Some people need to pick up in the spirit. You know what I mean? And Pastor Dave, I can pick up in the spirit. So did you? I said, yep. Pastor Dave. I know you. Man, good seeing you, man, of God. Thank God for you. Celebration, man. We have been so many different ways. The Bible says it over and over. It says this. It says you have 10,000 teachers. I don't think there's ever clearer than now today.
Yeah.
The Bible says you have 10,000 teachers, but you don't have many followers. Yeah. You can just open up your Facebook. You can send 10,000 teachers. Mm. You go on Instagram, see 10,000 teachers.
Mm-hmm.
You can see on Twitter, 10,000 teachers. But if you ain't nurturing, caring, covering, protecting, leading, God,
come on,
loving,
come on,
lifting people falling, you just a teacher.
That's right.
If I hurt, you can't touch my life, you just a teacher. If you can't feel my pain and reach me when I need you, you just a teacher. If you can't help me and my family, believe it or not, I know they're online, I know you're in your house, but they ain't gonna be there when you say, I need somebody to come see me tonight.
Yes.
Leave your family and come help my family.
Come on.
Don't play with me. See, I understand. And I'm at this season in my life to understand this. And some people.
Come on, Pastor. That's right.
I'm just going to preach to you. You're going to shout, dance. You might not ever change your life.
Come on.
And you won't follow me and my wife.
Uh huh.
As we follow Christ.
Come on.
And
come on.
I realize that to some people, I'm your pastor.
Yeah.
That wherever I am, you will be.
Yeah.
Sheep follow shepherds. I'm sorry. Sheep follow shepherds. Any confusion to me. And then there's people that I realize that I'm just an encourager.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you only turn it on when you want encouragement.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing wrong with that. You just got to know who you are.
Come on.
Praise God.
And you got to know how to give who you are. One of the greatest things the Lord taught me, when he taught me through pain, he says, your job is one job. I said, what's that? He said, love them deeply, but hold them loosely.
Yeah.
Mm.
What is that? He says, that's what I did. I had to love people deeply. But hold them loose.
That's right.
Because they will walk away.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, how did you handle 5,000? How did you handle 4,000 walk away? It didn't matter. I fed them. I took care of them. I loved them deeply.
Yeah.
But I didn't lose it when they walked away because I held them loose. And I believe that we learn to do those things and love people no matter who they are, where they are. Where
that's
they
right.
Are. God can honor it. Joel, if you would come real quick, I want to bless these palms, and we're going to have the man of God come and bless our life. This is a problem. Okay, yes. Come on. As Jesus was making that final turn toward Jerusalem, the Bible says that he came into the city, and as he came, they began to lift up palms. And when they began to lift up the palms, they were raising it up. What I love about the palms are actually a symbol of both humanity and divinity at the same time. There's something that has been sown into the earth that looked like it died, but came back up. And then when it came up, it got cut down.
Mm-hmm.
And then when it got cut down, it got laid down and lifted up.
Mm-hmm.
This is a reminder of who Jesus is to to us. He was sown down to be grown up, to be cut down to be lifted up. That's why we lift up the arms. That's why we lift up Hosanna. This week they sang Hosanna. Next week they sang Crucify. Love them deeply. Hold them loose. Father, we thank you for the reminder of both your humanity of being sown into this earth, living our life, dying, and then raising up, being cut down and being lifted up. We lift these palms back up to you. We bless each one of them to remind us, Father God, of the celebration of the Lamb of God that came to take away the sins of the world. We thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace as a reminder that every time we look at one of them, it was sown down, but it grew up. It was cut down, but it was lifted up. In celebration of your presence, your power, and your plan for redemption of all mankind, you came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. We bless you. We celebrate you. We honor you. In Jesus' name. Amen. The palms will be available outside of the sanctuary after service. Amen. I'll turn this over to Elder Wayne.
Come on, it's celebration time. Hallelujah. It's celebration time. Hallelujah. Just for a few moments. We are celebrating 25 years of incredible ministry. Amen? Amen. Amen. So Pastor Dave, if and Pastor Ronnie back, if y'all can just for a moment listen to the screen.
Oh my gosh, dude. Here we are. This is where it all started for us almost 13 years ago at the Frederick Douglass Christian School. And who would have thought that we would attend a church in Chester, PA? But the blessing is that when we came to visit,
thanks to the Huts for inviting us that Sunday.
Shout out to the Huts for inviting us. When we came to visit on that particular Sunday, and when Pastor Dave got to speaking, teaching, and preaching, and I looked over and I saw my husband sitting on the edge of his chair, just focused, I said, okay, God, this is our church home.
Amen.
So we just want to say, Pastor Dave, Pastor Byrne, wherever you guys go, as long as you continue to lead us, we will continue to follow you. And we just want to say thank you so much for accepting the call 25 years ago, because God knew that the Selbys, we need you all. And because of you guys, we are so much better.
Yes.
I'm a better person. Are you a better person? We all got better. And again, we have you guys and the TTW family to thank.
Thank you.
So again, thank you guys. Happy, happy 25th church anniversary.
Woo-hoo!
And on that note, we're going to say bye-bye.
Woo-hoo! They'll be.
Wow.
Beautiful.
Wow.
All right. Hi. We're so super excited to be celebrating 25 years of incredible ministry with two of the most incredible leaders in the entire nation.
Amen. Amen.
I am Deacon Sheree Platt.
And Deacon Mike.
We are standing here in front of the Christiana Hilton.
Where it all started for us.
Yes. Prior to coming here to this location, we had the opportunity to visit when you guys were still at Frederick Douglass.
And there is when I knew, when we first met you, that you two were definitely my spiritual parents. We were so excited. I was tired as church as usual, and the Lord just led us to you guys there. That night we went home, and we discussed, I was like, I don't know where they're at, but we have to find them because they are definitely our spiritual parents.
Amen. Amen.
And so as my husband said, with him being tired of church as usual, we had the wonderful privilege to be able to find them here at the Christiana Hilton, where we had the incredible privilege of also joining the Through the Word family, and our lives have been just completely amazing as a result of the experience of our connection, of being part of the TTW family.
Yes, yes, amen.
It's just been amazing. You guys just being our spiritual parents, we love you so much. Words can't describe how you have impacted our lives over the years, how you continuously built us up and strengthened us. We so appreciate and love you guys. Words can't describe. As my father would say, shove them.
And as Michael has already said, we so celebrate you. We so love you. We so appreciate you. And we know that the blessing of the Lord will rest on you all the days of your life. Yes. You have yet to see what he is going to make happen for you because of your faithfulness and your commitment to the people of God. So we celebrate you a million times over. Yes. And as our parents would say, bye-bye.
This is Mark Brett, and we're here at Quickly Boulevard. This is where it all started for me. I remember being disenchanted, disgraced, and asking God a lot of questions. And he brought me back here, and I remember seeing the sign, through the word, TTW. And the next day, I came back to service, and I met these two wonderful people, Dr. David B. Mills and Pastor Bernadette Mills. And I remember I got the Baptist handshake, and for those who know what that is, that's when somebody gave you a handshake with a little something. My life has just been turned around since then. I joined the church. I've been here about 3 years now, and it's just an honor and a privilege to serve under this great man and woman of God. They changed my life. My life has been transformed through this ministry, and I just want to say just thank you. I love you. I appreciate you. I'm a good father now. You helped me get integrity back in my life. I'm engaged to a wonderful woman. My mother is excited about getting my mother back. My children are glad they got their dad back. I'm excited I got me back. So I just thank God. I give God all the glory, honor, and praise for who you are in the earth. You're a great couple, great dynamic mother and father. I'm so glad to be a child of you. And I just want to say, happy 25 years of ministry. Don't look like you guys been doing it 25 years. You look young, you know, you sharp, you fly, you on flick, you got drip. You know, so I just thank God for you guys. I love you. I appreciate you. I just want to say happy 25th anniversary. And thank you for embracing me as a son. Bye-bye.
Amen.
She says, it's hard to believe, but here we are celebrating 25 years of ministry together. Mm-hmm. Not only have we experienced ministry together, our journeys together have been bound by uncommon love, friendship, and life. The two of you are just exceptional and deep. Because of who you are, you do exceptional, amazing things together for the kingdom of God. One of the things that I most admire about the two of you is the love you have for God. But what really inspires me is your absolute love for, dedication to, and burning passion for each other. It simply is remarkable. Your children, Christian, Destiny, Micaiah, Noah, and Gabrielle are some of the most blessed children in the world to have such parents like yourselves. Some of the best people in the world you are. Through the word, you must be so proud to call this man and woman of God your pastors. This makes you guys one of the most best churches because you have one of the most best, amazing, absolute, wonderful pastors.
Amen.
Here wishing you God's steadfast love. It never ceases. His perfect peace. It passes all understanding. His outrageous joy. It floods our hearts with the beauty and warmth of compassion. May you continually experience the awesome, inspirational realization of the Savior's presence of love. I salute you, my friends, and congratulate you, Pastor David and Pastor Bernadette Mills, for 25 years of ministry. Well done. Sincerely, Evangelist Dot White, March 27, 2021.
Amen.
Dr. David, Pastor Vernon, if you can stand, just come up this way and face the congregation. We are beyond blessed to have you as our spiritual mother and father. We are beyond blessed to have you as our pastors, our teachers, our leaders, and we are the better for it. I don't want to get emotional because I know the impact that you had on my life. I thank God for the leadership, just running with the vision. I thank God for the church, just being a part. You always said that God sets us up to set us under. You know that peace, you know that. So, and we're in the set up place. We're in the set up place.
Amen. Amen.
And so as you come down to the congregation, we are going to be giving up. Made with the banner on it as well as the each ministry that every person will be able to receive today. We have individual wrap cupcakes at the end of the service for our members and friends and family to pick up on your way out. And as of right now, we want to bless you from the leadership. We want to bless you from the church. We want to bless you from the congregation. I have cards that we want to add as Minister Elaine come up with a beautiful bag from Minister Eugene and Kamika and the Mack family. I have a card from Brother Reggie and Sister Barb Sumner. I have a card from Mom Cookie who made me come over here. She didn't even ask. She said, are you going out today? Do I need to? Yes, can you come over? I'll be right there, Miss Cookie. So we would like to add these to the bag, as well as members of church. You can stand as you come forth and just bless the Dr. Dave and Pastor Vernon. Amen? Amen. Amen. And can we move fast so we can have the word? We don't want to take anything away from the word. Thank you. Thank you. Amen. Just come forth. You can just come. Any way you direct, just come along. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Ministry name has the bag. Just love on and keep it moving. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
We're trying, Elder.
Oh, I don't know. We just thank you, Peter Word, for hearing the vision, for running with it, and we just honor you, Dr. Dave and Pastor Bernadette. And we know we celebrate 25 years of incredible ministry. Amen.
Can you celebrate the elders, amen, again, let's celebrate the Bible. And all the leaders, every member, we appreciate and value you. The Bible says that Paul said, you guys are the living epistles of the ministry. If anybody want to ask what kind of ministry you people have, you need to look at the body and the family. You need to look at people's family and see what kind of ministry you really have.
Wow.
I thank God for every one of you, because you are a demonstration of the kingdom for us.
Wow.
Your love, your lifestyle, your grace, the way you walk through this process. And again, I know I said it last week, but I got to say it again.
Thank you.
You proved the kingdom in the midst of a pandemic.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. I mean it. You served me. You served police, the fire department. You took care of the marketing staff while they were feeding people. You were feeding the people on the staff of the market. You took care of nurses. You took care of doctors. You took care of all kinds of people. And I celebrate you for not letting much as that moment be missed by us as the church, that we could bless the earth. So again, through the word, I honor you. I thank you.
Wow.
Thank you for being faith responders in the midst of first response. I thank you and celebrate you for who you are. And I decree and declare. The Bible says, whatsoever you make happen for a man, God will make it happen for you. God is going to make something happen for you. It's going to blow your mind.
As I ever
go
on and on about Pastor Dave, and we're going to be blessed. I just believe God's going to bless us with this word on this morning that's just going to continue to cause you to go where God has assigned you in your life. Let us be so sensitive to the Holy Spirit as we settle ourselves to receive what it is that God has ordained for us on this day. Amen. Let us prepare our hearts to receive at this time, Apostle Mount Dave.
Amen. Let's celebrate and thank you all, please. Don't tell me who you are, but tell me who you are. I celebrate. Don't tell me who you are, but tell me who you are. I am a terrible and powerful king.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
She know me don't do this. So. The only reason why. All right. Praise the Lord, everybody.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Praise the Lord, everybody. Yeah. I'm just happy to see the presence of the Lord if you can. And man, I am overwhelmed by being in the. I told Pastor Dave on my way in. I've always wanted to be in the movies. Stand below the stand in front of the screen, you know what I mean? But man, it's just an absolute delight for us to be able to be here to celebrate in this auspicious occasion. 25 years of pastoral ministry is absolutely phenomenal because when I think back over the time, I reflect on the fact that when the Lord gave me that word, I want you to know something, Vern, I ain't having a clue what apostle may be. Because at that time, I was still very Baptist.
Yes.
Come on.
And the Spirit of the Lord spoke through me that day. And it was that they weren't even in ministry at that time.
That's right.
I want y'all to hear this.
Come on.
They were not even in ministry.
That's right.
When the Spirit of the Lord gave me that word to release over them.
Yeah.
Wow.
And so to see them become obedient, of course, first of all, to the prophetic word that was released
Amen.
Over their life. And then to see how that word has now become all of this.
Yes.
This is absolutely amazing. This is fantastic for the way you're going to do it. I thank you all.
This is
absolutely phenomenal ministry. There are just no words for my wife and I as we think about the spiritual children that the Spirit of the Lord has given us to birth. And man, to know that undoubtedly, these two are, trust me, right up there at the top of our list when it comes down to how they because they take excellent care of us. And I say that unequivocally, they take excellent care of us. And not that we don't have other sons and daughters that do as well, but undoubtedly, They take excellent care of my wife and I, and there's absolutely nothing, and I mean nothing, in this world that we would not do for them.
Wow.
And so with that, I'm going to ask you to get out of her way.
My son and daughter in the middle.
Yes.
Dr. Day and Pastor Brown. They are two of the most incredible, awesome, amazing, anointed, wonderful, caring, loving, giving people in the whole wide world. Those of you who sit under their leadership, you are sitting under two great people, a great woman of God,
amen.
A great man of God.
Amen.
And I hope you understand the gift that God has bestowed upon each and every one of you. Pastors don't come like them.
That's right. Come on.
Pastors just don't come like
that's
them.
Right.
And because God, through his infinite wisdom, has guided you to through the word, he loved you so much and has so much in store for you under the leadership of these two. So I just want to acknowledge how much I love you. I appreciate you. You're always there for us. And you know, when you're spiritual leaders, you don't stop learning and you don't stop
growing. That's right.
Growing.
That's right.
And so I bless God that I can learn from them and that I can grow from them. Because you see, when you get to a certain place in life as a parent,
come on,
you don't know it all.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Come on.
Come on.
Amen.
And as the younger generation grows up, not that they're that much younger. But you learn from them.
That's
you
right.
Learn and grow, and that's how you stay young. That's how you stay current. Mm-hmm. That's how you stay growing.
Yeah.
Ever growing and ever learning. And so I thank God that I can learn from Pastor Byrne. I can learn from Pastor Dave. And you guys can learn from them as well.
Amen.
So I'm just excited today. I'm excited for 25 years. Remember the bondage that they seemed to be in at that time,
yes.
And the turmoil that was going on within them. They knew that there was something great that God had for them to do, but just what is it? And should I even stay here? Should I be here? I know there's something more, and certainly there was something more. And through the Word Ministries, that was there something more.
Amen.
So I just bless God for their yes, and I thank God to be part of their lives and to have them in my life. So God bless you. I love you so very, very much. I love you dearly. There's nothing that I wouldn't do for you. And I know as your church family, there's nothing that they wouldn't do for you. So please
amen.
All stand on your feet just one more time. And just acknowledge your gift.
Maximize our time, and I don't want to shortchange God or you with what the Lord has laid in my heart for us for today.
Yes.
While we're ready to look at the scripture, I truly want to thank the Lord for our son to build with us today.
Yeah.
And our son David, James, and our daughter Teresa and Dawn were with us today. And
awesome.
We're celebrating James and Teresa getting married next
Woo-hoo.
Week. Tremendous gifts in our life. And that's the way that I look at it. They are gifts to us. I don't ever want to seem like I want to try to take advantage of someone, you know, and think that this will be you trying to serve me, serving my wife, and that's not what it's about.
Yes.
And because they are gifts that God places in our life. Every one of you is a gift to this man and to this woman.
Yes.
Amen. And there was no way in the world that we could ever do any of what we do if it had not been for you. If you have your Bible, whatever medium that you use for the word of the Lord, I want you to turn with me now to the 15th chapter of the book of Judges. 15th chapter of the book of Judges. I'm not preaching the traditional Palm Sunday message. I know I'm free to do that in this house.
Amen.
Judges chapter 15. I want to read verses 9 through 17, if you'll indulge me. Verses 9 through 17 is where I want to take our attention for today. Judges chapter 15, verses 9 through 17. And if you haven't, would you please say amen.
Amen. Amen.
Listen to the word of the Lord. Now the Philistines went up and camped in Judah and deployed themselves against Lehi. And the men of Judah said, "Why have you come up against us?" So they answered, "We have come up to arrest Samson, to do to him as he has done to us." Then 3,000 men of Judah went down to the cleft of the rock of Etam and said to Samson, "Do you know that the Philistines rule over us? What is this you have done to us?" And he said to them, "As they did to me, so I have done to them." But they said to him, "We have come down to arrest you, that we may deliver you into the hand of the Philistines." Then Samson said to them, "Swear to me that you will not kill me yourselves." So they spoke to him, saying, "No, but we will tie you securely and deliver you into their hand, but we will surely not kill you." And they bound him with two new ropes and brought him up from the rock. When he came to Lehi, the Philistines came shouting against him. Then the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon him, and the ropes that were on his arms became like flax that is burned with fire, and his bonds broke loose from his hands. He found a fresh jawbone of a donkey, reached out his hand and took it, and killed 1,000 men with it.
Jesus.
Then Samson said, "With the jawbone of a donkey, heaps upon heaps, with the jawbone of a donkey, I have slain 1,000 men." And so it was. This is so important, you can't even underline this. And so it was, when he had finished speaking, that he threw the jawbone from his hand and called that place Ramath Lehi. I want to use for a thought from that passage today, uncommon grace for an uncommon situation. Uncommon grace for an uncommon situation. God bless you. Have your seats in the presence of Almighty God. I am so certain that all of us can agree that by nature, we as human beings are pretty much beings of habitual mannerisms. All of us work habitually, and meaning that we will do the same thing at the same time. You do the same way.
Come on.
Always, each and every day, we continue to do the same thing, same time, and the same way. Never, ever breaking the pattern. Even to the point, Mike, to where it looks as if that sometimes our life becomes very predictable.
Mm-hmm.
Because of how it is that we're always repeating things habitually, over and over and over and over again. Because of that, though, David, what I've learned is that what we've done is that we bring ourselves into a place of confinement, of containment. And here it is that the Lord says in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, "Now unto him was able to do what? Exceeding, abundantly, and all we could ever ask for think." But of course, it's according to the power of the ability that works in you and me.
Yes.
And so therefore, children of God, the Lord never intended that our lives would be a life of containment, nor would it be a life of confinement. In fact, even there in the garden, when the first man and woman were created, they were created so that they would have abundance all around them.
Yeah.
Jesus came and he solidifies that. John 10:10, the thief comes but to steal, to kill, and to destroy.
Mm-hmm.
I have come, he said, that you may have life and that life what?
More abundantly
is what he intends for you and I. There should never, ever be any containment. Now, also, we got to consider that there is also, God says, a grace that is placed upon every individual's life.
Yes.
Every one of us in this room, there's a certain measure of grace that the Lord has imparted into your life so that you are able to accomplish and to achieve all that he has sent you into the planet to accomplish. We must realize that grace is so much more than just God's unmerited favor.
Yeah.
But again, I say to you that it is the ability for you to be able to accomplish whatever it is that God has placed in your being.
Amen.
And this should never, ever be framing from your mouth that I can't do this or I can't do the other, because to do that is to make God a liar.
Come on.
And of course, we know that God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. And for some of us, because of the level of assignment that is upon your life, you also are going to have an uncommon grace.
Yeah. Come on.
There's a supernatural ability that should be flowing in and through and out of your
yes.
life. And it's unfortunate that what I found, though, is that there are many people, James, who do not allow themselves to move to that place of the supernatural.
Mm-hmm.
There are too many of us that really don't understand even the supernatural abilities that are afforded you because of the supernatural power of the living God that dwells on the inside of us.
Good.
And here it is that the word of the Lord says that with him, all things are possible. But there's a condition, that is, if you believe, it is up to you. So therefore, the quantity and the quality of your life is not dependent upon what God does, but it's according to what it is that you believe.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And so we have to understand then, as I said, that there's this measure of grace. There's this uncommon grace that's upon some of our lives. And so it is with the life of Samson. Now, even though Samson had this great ability, and I don't believe that Samson looked like Arnold Schwarzenegger. I really don't believe he looked that way. I believe that he had a very natural stature, a very common stature is what I really believe, because if in fact he was like Arnold Schwarzenegger, then of course everybody would have always been terrified of him, that kind of thing. But when looking at Samson, I believe that he was a guy who had a common stature, and as a result of it, that's what gave it the uncommon flavor.
Yes.
And so here it is that Samson, being as strong as he was, yet Samson had a problem.
Yeah.
And Samson's problem was women.
Come on.
Read it very carefully.
Come on.
Samson's problem was women.
Yes.
He was chasing women and he could not help himself. Here it is that he, even not only was he a strong man, but Samson also was the last judge of Israel.
Yeah.
He was a judge as well. Well, yeah, we read the scripture very carefully. He was also a judge.
Wow.
And so here it is that Samson has this problem with women. So we have to fast forward because for sake of time, we have to look at the fact that Samson gets married.
Yeah.
Now, he actually pleaded with his father and his mother to get this Philistine woman for him.
Mm-hmm.
And the father and mother pleaded back with him and said, look, Samson, say, all these beautiful women we have in our own tribe, why in the world would you want to have this woman who is a Philistine? She's a part of the enemy camp.
Yeah.
Samson said, I don't care what you say, Dad, Mom, I want her. Isn't it amazing how it is that some of our children? Y'all better move from that.
Come on.
But sometimes they won't listen to us, even though it is that we can see some things that they
can't
see. Some things that we've already gone through that
they haven't
gone through yet. And so they won't receive the advice until they have to go through it themselves.
Yes.
And then come back and say, Dad, Mom, you know. But nonetheless, Samson goes on. He marries the woman. Then after he marries this woman, on his way to the feast, because they knew how to party back then, Lord. They didn't have a one-day feast. They partied for 7 days. Okay? And so Samson's on his way to the feast, and he goes there. He kills a lion. And when he kills the lion, he comes back by a day later, and he comes back and he sees there's honey inside the carcass of the lion. And man, Samson's able to eat from it. He even gave his dad and his mom some. And he goes on to the feast. When he gets there to the feast, there are men who are there, and he poses a riddle to them. And he poses a riddle about this dead lion who ends up with honey inside of his carcass.
Yeah.
And he tells them, if you can figure out what my riddle is. He says, no problem. What I'm going to do, I'll give you 30 pieces of garments. He said, if you don't guess, he said, you got to pay me. They said, no problem. Since we like that deal. Okay, well, the feast goes on. At the end of the feast, 7 days later, they haven't figured it out. But what they did is that they started to threaten Samson's wife.
Yeah.
They threatened his wife and told her that if in fact you don't tell us what that really is, so we're going to burn you and your daddy up.
Come on.
That's how serious they were about it. And so the Bible says that she went to Samson, and he also was a weak man.
Yes.
He was physically strong, emotionally weak. Is what Samson was. She continued to press him and press him until finally he told her the secret. She goes back and tells the Philistines, and they were able to figure out the riddle. Samson lost it. And when Samson lost it, the Bible says that what he did is that he went down to another town, Ashkelon, and went down to Ashkelon and killed 30 men.
Yes.
He killed 30 people, took their clothes, and took them back to the guys who wanted to kill them. That's what the Bible says. That's exactly what the Bible says. After he killed all the people, then he goes back, he gives them the garments, and watch this. And to show you how the enemy moves against us, y'all, the Bible also says that his daddy didn't think now that he was going to want the daughter, so he took the daughter and gave her to his best man. Now, this made me wonder, though, Dave, first of all, why in the world would the best man even take her?
All right, now.
Knowing that this is his boy, his wife. I could be there for a long time, though. But nonetheless, he accepted the woman. And so Samson went away angry, but he came back later on because now he wants his wife back. And he bought a gift with him even when he came back. When he came back, and then the dad said, well, look, Samson, you can't have her no more. You have to take her baby sister, said, because I gave her to your friend, so you can't have her. He went off again. And the Bible says that he found 300 foxes, tied their tails together, and let them loose against the olive groves and against the vineyards and also against their wheat fields and burned all of their goods up. Now the Bible says that here come the Philistines. Now we come to our text, because the Philistines didn't like that either. And so the Bible says that now they came looking for Samson in verse number 9. Now the Philistines went up and camped in Judah and deployed themselves against Lehi. And the men of Judah said, why have you come up against us? Why are you blaming us for what he did?
Come on.
This ain't our fault. We didn't do anything to you. Samson did that. But understand something, children of God. There are going to be those instances when the enemy will come up against you and you'll be wondering to yourself, why is it that the enemy is attacking me at this time? As far as I'm concerned, I didn't do anything.
Come on.
Say something to your child of God. There's going to be those instances when you don't have to do anything.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
You get the glory, ask Job. The Bible said that Job was a perfect and upright man.
That's what he said.
He was a man who, the Bible says, eschewed evil. He had nothing wrong. Please know this, y'all, that there's going to be those instances when they come to get everything right. That's the reason why you got attacked.
Come on.
Are y'all still here? I'm going to say it again. When you've done everything right, you will get attacked. Because of the fact that you dared to stand for right, you dared to stand for righteousness, because you dared to do those things that are holy and upright before God, and that's the reason why you got attacked. So they're saying to the Philistines, why are you coming after us? It was Samson who did this to y'all. Now look at verse number 10. So it says, and the men said, why have you come up against us? So they answered, we have come up to arrest Samson to do to him as he has done to us. Now, please understand something also, y'all. The enemy only attacks those that attack him.
That's good.
The devil is not going to ever come against you if you don't present yourself as a threat.
That's right.
If the enemy does not see in any shape, way, or form that you are able to do anything that is going to somehow negate forward, void out or cancel his kingdom, then there is no way that he's going to attack you.
That's right.
Because there are some of us who are saying, well, you know, I don't know what it is. The devil won't be bothering me. It's only because he's bothering you.
He's talking.
Y'all hear what I'm saying? While there are others of us that are going to be saying, you know, I don't know what it is. It seems like the devil always after me. And it's because of the fact that you present yourself as a threat.
My God.
And y'all still here. So watch this. So then 3,000 men of Judah went down to the cleft of the rock of Etam and said to Samson, "Do you know that the Philistines rule over us? What is this you have done to us?" So in other words, they said, "Look here, Samson, why are you disturbing our peace?" Say, "Look, we are friends with the government." We're friends with the government. We have done nothing against them. Why in the world would you have them to incite riot against us? Samson, here it is that you are now causing the government to now look at us in a negative form, negative fashion. So why is it then, well, here it is that during this pandemic, that some of us have made ourselves more dependent upon the government? Than you have at looking at being a citizen of the kingdom.
Come on.
Because let me say something. I'm not against the stimulus checks. I thank God for the stimulus
checks. Come on.
Amen. That's a blessing, no doubt about that. However, that's not something you should be dependent upon.
That's right. Come on, Pastor.
And the only reason why many of us are dependent upon the government is because we never took the time to establish anything on our own.
Amen.
Because why is it that you have not been utilizing the grace?
That's right.
Placed upon your life to make sure that you put yourself in position so that no matter what took place in society or in the culture or with the government, that you are always going to be able
to make
sure you can take care
Amen.
Of yourself.
Woo.
What about the creative abilities that exist inside of everybody in this room?
Come on.
That before the foundation of the world was ever laid, that
Jesus.
God has put something inside of you that literally is going to change the landscape of the world, change society.
Yeah.
And God's this here. My question also is this. Why are you praying for God to rid you of problems that you were created to solve? Every one of us in this room, you were sent into this earth realm to be able to solve a problem. And the only reason why some of us right now are discouraged, why you're frustrated, and it seems that sometimes your life is in disarray, is because you have yet to discover the problem that God sent you to solve. But it said, "What did you do to us?" Then nobody said. And he said to them, "As they did to me, so I have done to them." Look, child of God, stop spending your time trying to get revenge.
Come on. Come on.
Stop putting yourself in a position to where you believe that because somebody offended you, that you're going to have to make sure you get them back.
Jesus.
Listen, let me tell you something. You can't be offended unless you allow yourself to be.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
Let me say that to you again. You cannot be offended except you allow yourself to be. Psalm 119, verse 165. It says it right there. Or somebody's laughing. I know you already heard this one, right? It says, "Great
Jesus,
peace have they.
Come on.
We love your law.
My.
Nothing shall offend them." So in other words, the Bible says, the more words you get in,
that's right,
the less you can be offended.
Amen.
What's this? Not only that, but the more words you have in you, the greater your faith quotient is inside your life as well.
Amen.
So the only reason why many of us are not at the place of strength or power where you should be is because of the fact that you keep on hearing the word, but you do not apply the word.
That's right.
Yes.
Stop getting a whole bunch of information.
Come on, Apostle.
Because revelation will ultimately provide you with the power.
That's right. That's right.
To be able to satisfy God's will and His plan and His purposes for your life. You got to get to the point to where you learn how to live a life of destiny.
That's
a
right.
A life of purpose. And even though for 25 years, for some folks who've been sitting inside this congregation for that length of time, and still have not yet realized personal
come
purpose.
On, come on.
Wow.
See, it's easy to hide inside of a congregation like
that's
this.
Right, that's right. You teach an apostle.
Don't disrespect anybody in here. But it's easy to hide in a congregation like this because of the fact that this ministry is doing so many things and because of the visibility of the ministry.
Come on.
And, of course, of the visibility of your leaders.
That's right.
It becomes easy to be able to hide inside the confining context of the ministry
my.
Never ever come to a place of personal fulfillment.
Wow.
Jesus.
Are y'all hearing what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because where's your strength? If the enemy catch you by yourself, without being in the crowd, Are you able to defend yourself? Are you able to really demonstrate the power of the living God to come out of your life if I catch you by your...
Come on!
Or will you have to refer me to Pastor Dave?
Uh-huh.
Or will you have to refer me to Pastor Byrne? Are y'all still here?
Yeah.
Okay, let me go forward. I only got a couple more minutes. So then the other says, we came down to arrest you that we may deliver you into the hands of the Philistines. And so then it says, then Samson said to them, swear to me that you will not kill me yourselves. Isn't it awesome, Byrne, how it is that sometimes the people who will come against you and offend you and seek to destroy you the most are those who say they love you.
Uh-huh.
The people who always say that I'm always here for you. The people who say that if you call me at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, I got your back. Uh-huh. The people who say, no matter what it is that you stand in need of, I'm always here for you.
Come on.
And they'll be the very ones to turn you over to the devil.
Sure enough, will.
Amen. The very ones that will walk away from you and will not be there for you when it is that you are in some of the deepest, darkest moments of your life, and it is that you have found yourself trying to depend on these individuals who say
that
they got your back. But in actuality, when it comes time for them to step up to the plate,
they
can't be found nowhere.
Amen.
They don't answer a text, they don't answer a phone, they don't answer IG, they don't answer you on Twitter,
nothing.
They don't answer you on LinkedIn, they don't come
nothing.
On all the platforms, they don't come on none of them.
That's right.
They got no time for you right now.
Jesus.
Why? Because watch this. Many of us don't desire to be tested.
My God.
We do not desire, let me say it again, to be tested.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there are too many people I found, David, that live a comfortable life.
Mm-hmm. Come on.
Because watch this. Watch this. They would much rather live a life where they can control everything.
That's right.
They do not want to be in a position to where they are forced into a place to where they have now got to go to their next dimension of grace.
Come on.
You know, remember what the Bible says in Romans chapter 1, verse 17. It said we go from what?
Faith to faith.
Going out from what?
Faith to faith. That's
so
right.
Therefore, you cannot allow yourself to stay where you've always been. Because there are some of us in this room right now that the Lord is trying to move you to the next dimension of grace, and you are stubbornly staying right where you are because you are comfortable with just enough. I'm still here.
My.
Okay. So look what it says. He said, don't y'all kill me yourself. So they spoke to him saying, no, but we will tie you securely and deliver you into their hand. But we will surely not kill you. And they bound him with two new ropes and brought him up from the rock. Now, what made them think that that was going to be able to bind up Samson? They've already seen the demonstrations. They've already seen him kill 30 men by himself. They've already seen him tie up 300 foxes and loose them into their fields. They've already heard the thing that he's done to be able to fight against the Philistines and other armies before. What made them think that two small ropes was going to contain this man? And so here's the thing, child of God. The question now looms large for you and me. What is it that is able to bind you?
Jesus. Jesus.
Amen.
What is it that the enemy can use to bind you up and to make you think that you have no response? To make you think that you are not able to fight back. Because, child of God, there should be nothing. There should be no weapon that is formed against you that can ever.
That's right.
Watch this here. Let me tell you something. The greatest tool and the greatest weapon, Raheem, that the enemy uses against us, watch this, is emotionalism.
Uh-huh.
Yes, it is. Yes.
He is trying to get you to respond to the matters of life through your emotion and to never, ever do it through your spirit, man.
You need help, though.
Because there are too many of us that most of the time in your conversation, I feel this.
Come on.
I feel that. And the word of the Lord didn't ask you to feel anything. Except they are led by the Spirit of God. They are the sons or the daughters of God. This is never ever about your feelings. And unfortunately, what has happened is that many of us have found on where our feelings on our sleeve. And the enemy has identified it. And that's the reason why he tried to get you to live your life with your heart hanging out your chest. right in this house. Because watch this here, y'all. Now watch this. I am not saying that you should ever deny your feelings.
Come on.
We have feelings, absolutely.
That's
you
right.
You should not be denying your feelings. However, you should not be controlled by them.
Amen.
That's right.
Don't allow yourself to become an emotional junkie. The one thing about Jesus is that his emotions never controlled him.
Wow.
Jesus. Lazarus was dying. He said, no problem. He said, I'll get there when he's dead. Am I right?
Yes.
That's what the Bible says. He waited until the man was dead. In fact, he waited until the man was dead 4 days. That's when he finally showed up. Now, there's a couple of reasons for that. First of all, because of the fact he was not dead by his emotions. That's number one. Secondly, because of the fact that the Jews believed that if an individual was dead for at least 4 days, that their spirit had gone back to God. And that there was no way in the world that they could be resurrected.
Wow.
But that's the reason why the Lord wants to give us uncommon grace.
That's right. That's right. Amen.
He wanted to show and demonstrate uncommon grace
Come on.
To them and to show them what the power of the living
Jesus.
God actually looks like in the life of a believer.
Jesus.
Amen.
Yeah. Glory to God.
Let's go. I'm almost done, y'all. And so it says, when he came to Lehi, the Philistines came shouting against him. They came out shouting. Let me tell you something, y'all. Stop being intimidated by the threats of the devil. As a roaring lion, he walks about.
Seeking.
As a roaring lion. Watch this. He can only roar. Because all his teeth was kicked out of
cage.
Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? So he's only a roaring lion. And so watch this. Why is it then, child of God, are you intimidated by threats that come from the enemy's camp?
Come on.
And they tell you they're going to lock you up. They tell you they're going to take away your business. They tell you they're going to take away your notoriety. Watch this here. Do you understand that sometimes your demotion can be your promotion?
Hello.
I'm going to say it again. Sometimes your devotion can become your promotion.
Yeah.
Do you understand that sometimes, in order for you to be promoted, you got to walk into a fire first?
La, la, la.
The Bible says that the three Hebrew boys, y'all know what they call them, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The Bible says you throw them into a fire, and watch this, they went into the fire willingly. That's right, they walk in willingly. Walk in fully clothed. And the Bible says that watch this, they threw them into that fire. The Bible says they fell down into the fire. But then when Nebuchadnezzar looked inside the fire, they were up and walking around. And the Bible says they're walking around loose.
That's right.
Are y'all hearing me? The bonds had already fallen off of them. They were walking around loose inside the fire. Now, watch this, y'all. They're walking around loose inside the fire. So in that spot, they could have walked out anytime they got ready. Because they were loose. They were loose inside the fire. They're walking around inside the fire. Could have walked out anytime they got ready. But the reality is this here. You and I cannot walk out of a fire until you're called out.
Hallelujah. Yes, sir.
I said you have to wait until you're called out. Because the Bible said that Nebuchadnezzar saw them in there, said, man, didn't we cast in three? They said, sure did, King. Said, well, why do I see four? And the fourth one looks like the Son of God. And then he said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, come out.
My.
So that's why you have to wait until you're called out.
Yes.
And watch this, and when they got called out, the Bible says that they walked out and they didn't even smell like smoke.
Come on!
Didn't even smell like fire. But the last verse of that chapter says this, and then the king promoted them. And so therefore, child of God, everyone's got to wait. The only reason why you have not been promoted yet is because you have still got to walk around in the fire. And when you get called out, promotion is waiting on you. Uncommon grace, uncommon favor is waiting on you when you come out of the fire.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
What did you have called
out?
Glory
right
to
now,
God.
There's somebody around you right now. Tell them, don't come out yet.
Don't come out yet.
Don't come out yet.
That's right.
And then it says, the Philistines came shouting against him. Then the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon him. And the ropes that were on his arms became like flax that is burned with fire, and his bonds broke loose from his hands. The Spirit of the Lord. Now, look at this. Samson has messed up bad. Samson has killed people. Samson has destroyed property. And yet, God uses him.
Come on. Jesus. Woo!
Hey! Do you understand the child of God that sometimes, no matter what the deficiency may be in your life,
come on!
The weaknesses may be in your life, what the discrepancy might be in your life, what your shortcomings might be in your life, what your flaws might be, what your weaknesses might be. Do you understand that no matter what it is, that God can provide you with an uncommon grace, and he can still use you no matter what you've done, no matter where you've been? You might have been in jail. You might have been a junkie. You might have been a prostitute. You don't know what you've been, no matter what you've done, God can still use you and use you mightily.
Yes!
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Why do you could put yourself down when God is trying to lift you up?
My.
Why do you keep on saying you're nobody when God, in his eyesight, says you're somebody? He's somebody, you're somebody to him, and God wants to use you more mightily than you ever could have imagined.
Hallelujah.
David was a whoremonger. Solomon was a whoremonger. Abraham was a liar. Isaac was a liar. Rahab was a prostitute. What makes you think that God can use you? I'm almost done. I'm almost done, y'all. I promise I'm almost done. You can look what it says. It says, he found a fresh jawbone of a monkey. Goodness. Reached out his hand and took it and killed 1,000 men with it.
Yes.
A donkey's jawbone. 16 inches long, 7 inches wide.
Yes.
Let me tell you something. The Lord don't always need something huge to be able to bring deliverance.
Hallelujah.
Do you understand that sometimes your little bit is all that God needs?
Amen.
And all the Lord wants to do is take your natural and put his super on it. That's all the Lord wants to do.
That's
and
right.
Have this jawbone. A jawbone of a donkey against swords and spears and bow and arrows. Isn't it amazing, honey, that out of all of what was going on as far as the weaponry was concerned, that nobody ever used a bow and arrow against it? How God kept that at bay.
Yes, sir.
How it is that they use all them swords and spears against them, and hear that he is totally outnumbered, 1,000 to 1. Oh, what the scripture says. When you one can put up. Come on, y'all. But if I get another Holy Ghost filled baptized believer alongside of me, two can do what?
10,000. Yes.
But he was able to slay back a 1,000 men. 1,000 men with the jawbone of a donkey. Look what he said. With the jawbone of a donkey, heaps upon heaps. With the jawbone of a donkey, I've slain 1,000 men. 1,000 men slain, watch this, and the jawbone never broke.
Come on!
Uncommon grace for an uncommon situation. He was totally outflanked, totally outnumbered, and yet God gave him what appeared to be something that no human being would ever think about utilizing, and he picks it up, and it becomes a weapon in his hand. Oh, watch this, and then also, don't forget about that little boy with a sling.
That's right.
Come on.
All he had was a slingshot against a 9-foot-9-inch giant. Oh, let me show you this. This is the most important point. Listen, this is verse 17. I got to get here. And so it was. Watch this, Dave. When he had finished speaking, then he threw the jawbone from his hand and called that place Ramath Lehath. He threw it away. Watch this. That no longer was a part of his ministry.
My.
That's it.
Why is it? James, that sometimes what we do is that the Lord gives us something to use at a particular time. He places a grace upon it at that time, but then we want to adapt it to be something eternal. Because Buster's mic, I found out for some of us, what will happen is if we had that jawbone, then tomorrow we'd have printed cards and called it Holy Jawbone Ministry.
It's true.
But now, through it.
And wait.
And so once the grace of God that has been on you for that particular moment, for that particular event and moment in life, get rid of what it is. Don't be trying to take something that God graced in this season into the next dimension.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, because you may have had a jawbone of a donkey in this season, but maybe in the next season, all you need is your hand. Child of God, think about this. All he wants to do is place upon you this uncommon grace. But you got to be aware of what that grace is, why you have it, when you're supposed to utilize it, and then once that season has ended, move on. Because there's
that's right.
In my mind that through the word, you're ready to go into a new season.
Amen.
You can't take that job home.
Amen.
There's a major anointing in this house.
Yes.
There's a greater grace.
Yes.
That is about to abide in this house.
Amen.
And every one of you must be able to now receive from this new grace that's going to be upon this house.
Yes.
And as this grace comes upon this house, it means that whatever it was that was in the last season must stay in that season.
Yes.
Don't you dare try to take it when you cross over.
Yes.
Because I guarantee you, when you get ready to go, you've never been this way before.
Amen.
And what I just said, and the grace that is going to be upon this house is going to be something that this house has never experienced before.
Amen.
I don't care how great the worship has been. I don't care how great the praise has been. I don't care how great the word has been. There's going to be now an uncommon grace going to come upon you. And watch this, and the grace that's going to come upon you is going to require a greater faith.
Yeah.
You're going to have to trust God in ways that this ministry has never trusted God before.
Amen.
I hear the Lord saying millions upon millions.
Wow.
You're going to have to trust God for millions upon millions.
Yeah.
When this man or woman of God starts talking millions, don't you dare become afraid.
Amen.
Don't be frightened by hearing those kind of figures.
Yeah.
There's going to be an uncommon grace.
Yeah.
That is about to be released on this house.
Yes.
And whatever the grace is that's going to be on them is going to be on every one of you.
Yes.
And so therefore, there are some of you in this room right now that there's some proposals on the table. I sense it in my spirit. There's some proposals.
Oh, glory to God.
Right now.
Jesus.
And some of you in this room are terrified to make the move because of the fact that this is something that you've never done before. No, you've never been this way before, but you never had to trust God at this level.
Yes. Jesus. Jesus. Jesus.
I said, stop being scared.
Yes.
Jesus.
He said, I'll never leave you.
Glory to God.
I'll forsake you. And he said, if I can kill a thousand men with a jawbone, what makes you think that I cannot put millions in your bank account tomorrow?
Yes.
Do you understand that the daddy that you serve is not broke?
Yes.
Come on.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The Lord says he's a rock.
Yeah.
He's a fortress.
Yeah.
He's a strong tower.
Yeah.
He's my shield.
Yeah, God.
He's
yeah, God.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
In him.
Yes. Jesus.
This uncommon grace.
Yeah.
Glory, glory.
On my life. And yes, for the last year, and I pray with this, for the last year, undoubtedly, it's been an uncommon situation.
Yes.
Uncommon, man. None of us
yes.
have seen this before. No matter how old some of us may be in this room right now, we've never seen
come
it
on.
Before. But look at the grace.
Jesus!
That the Lord provided.
Yes.
For every one of us to get through this.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And my sister, I don't care if you have hot dogs every day.
Come on.
Thank God for the hot dogs.
Come on.
We have a hot dog, we don't even have a bun to go with it. But thank God.
Yes, Jesus.
If it was Vienna sausage, thank God for it. The Lord still
provides. Amen.
Because of the uncommon grace. And as Vern and also Pastor Dave said earlier on, there are some of us in this room that you flourished and you prospered in ways that you never could have imagined. in the midst of a famine. Because of whatever the Lord has said, he said, I will take care of you even in the midst of a famine. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. But the Lord delivers him or her out of them. How many?
All.
Why? Because he will provide uncommon grace in the midst of your uncommon situation. So, Father, thank you. What you're getting ready to do for us. We bless you, God. We glorify, we magnify, we worship, we honor, we love, and we adore, we exalt, and we extol your holy name. Oh, you've been so good. You've been so kind, such a loving Father. We thank you for your great grace. Because truly, Father, your grace is sufficient for every one of us. Lord, we're praying now that your hand be mighty upon Pastor David, Pastor Burns, they go into this next season.
Yes.
And Lord God, that already you have promised them, even in their own private time.
Yes.
You told them about the great things that you're about to take them into. And Lord God, the pathway of grace and favor that they're about to be upon, Lord God. And Father Heaven, that the favor that's going to be upon them will be as such of a magnitude, Lord, that it is going to cause them to shudder to think that you would love them.
Jesus.
Oh, my Father in heaven, I pray over every home, every family that is represented under the sound of my voice. And Lord God, I pray that even right now, that you're releasing even greater favor, a greater grace that will be upon every one of them. Father, you have promised us in your word that your favor will surround us like a shield.
Yes.
And we believe you for it. Thank you, oh God, just for the next steps that you're about to take upon, oh God. That even though, Father God, we may not know exactly where it is that we're headed, but you know.
Yes.
Because, Father, you're already in our tomorrow.
Thank you.
And so, Father, as you do these things for us, we're going to be so careful and ever so mindful to give you and you alone all the praise, all the honor, all the glory that only you deserve.
Yes.
For the blessed and glorious and awesome and wonderful and powerful name of Jesus the Christ, we pray this prayer with thanksgiving. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Oh, my God. Bless your eyes. Yeah. Yeah. Let's go ahead and celebrate the man of God. Uncommon grace for uncommon situation. You can figure, just declare that to somebody today. You have uncommon
grace
for uncommon situations.
I know that's right.
Now say it to yourself. I have uncommon grace. For uncommon situations.
For uncommon situations.
You receive it. Let's celebrate the Lord today. I have uncommon grace for uncommon situations.
Assignment. This was a prophetic word in preparation for where God is moving us into. It's not something that's going to take a long time to come to pass.
Hallelujah.
It's going to happen. This is a quick word.
Jesus. My God.
And so we have to really go back and review it, reflect on it, saturate ourselves with it, and go back and read this word for ourselves, especially those who are assigned to us. We know our leadership is assigned to us, but there are some of you who are sitting out there, you are assigned to us. Some of you are on social media. You are assigned to us.
Amen.
You may be other places around the world, but you're assigned to us.
Amen.
And you received this word the way it was deposited in our hearts from today. Mm-hmm. And so you need to make sure you're ready for where God has already established us to go. And so we love you, Apostle and Mom Dev. And thank you for obeying God. For His word. And we need to be around somebody else and we enjoy in ourselves. And that's what we want to do. Because God is gracious. But remember to say to that person, remember the uncommon grace. Remember the uncommon situation that God is bringing us into. And so continue to keep each other built up into that place because it's God who have established it. And remember the words that were spoken on today.
Amen.
This word is to remind us and prepare us and position us, because if it's uncommon, we don't have anything to do with it.
Say it.
We're not responsible for it. God is going to do it. And it's going to blow the minds of even us as God moves on our behalf. So it's not just for us. He said every person attached to us.
Yes. That's right.
Will walk this out.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
So prepare to receive what God has. And he said, don't be afraid.
Amen.
Don't be afraid.
Yeah.
It is for you, even though it seems bigger than you. It is for you, even though it costs more than what your bank account
my,
is.
My,
it
my.
Is for you,
my,
even
my,
though
my.
It is for us, because it's been spoken. And it shall come to pass.
Amen.
Wow, we receive it. Amen. We receive that. I want to celebrate the Lord. We receive it. Amen. We're going to put ourselves out there on all things. Amen. We're going to put ourselves out there on all things. Facebook family, you already know. We're on the screen. We'll put it up for you. Our tithes and offers. TTW BFC at Cash App. And then also on PayPal, you can go to the website and be able to go in through there. And then also, if you're here in present, and if you want to sow, we have our elders over to the side that you can bring forth an envelope and a check. And those kind of things you can make a sow over to the basket to our left. We're going to be blessing the man of God today, our father, our spiritual leader,
yes.
Apostle Gilbert. I don't know about you. You are done with common things. You are done with common places. You are done with common people. God is trying to bring you
into Jesus.
Look where you at.
Yes.
It's uncommon
yes.
in a church, in a movie theater.
Nobody but God.
Prophetic. He let you sit in uncommon things and do uncommon things so you can hear and be able to see it functioning in your life already. You're standing in uncommon. You're walking in uncommon. And you will see the uncommon in every situation of your life. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's prepare ourselves to sow our tithes and our offering today. As you see, TTWBSC on Cash App, as well as you can go to throughtheword.dbm.org and also take you to PayPal. You may do that. Then again, our elders are on to the side as far as the baskets, as far as those things. Amen. We want to prepare ourselves to give, and then we're going to close out. Thank you again, Facebook. Thank you also, our IG family. We thank God for all of you. We release you now. We thank God for your love and for your grace.
I'm really excited, as Pastor Dave said, so if you're prepared to give and you need to come down to see the elders, please do so. But in our excitement of all that is taking place, this Tuesday is the Game Changers graduation.
Woo-hoo!
We are super. It's also my birthday, so I'm super excited. It's the first time I'll be seeing 55, yes, and I'm excited about the double portion, about the great grace, any uncommon favor. But on Tuesday night, Dr. Cindy Trim will be here speaking on every graduate and empowering and imparting what it means to regain your personal power.
Amen.
For every graduate, those who have been here for 3 to 4 times in a row for the Game Changers Tuesday night women event will be graduating. This time is also open to every Through the Word member, but you must confirm on today. You must register. I so love everybody who's trying to come since they seen the flyer. But because we have to walk in order and alignment, that means on tonight after 5 or 6 o'clock, you can't say tomorrow, oh, Pastor Byrne, I forgot to tell you I was coming. Because when you're intentional, you'll move out.
That's right.
And so we have to be in alignment and accordance. And so I want to say thank you to all of Through the Word who has responded to say you're definitely going to be there on Tuesday night. We already have over 40 graduates and facilitators.
Yes.
So I ask our 8 facilitators to please stand. I just want to say thank you to them who are standing right now. To Keisha, to Minister Judy, to Elder and Elder, to Deacon Sheree and Deacon Jamison, to Claudia and to Tasha. Thank you so much for taking leadership over all of these women. Thank you to the men for setting up. Thank you to the men for being there on Tuesday night to make sure everything is in place. On Tuesday night, we will be here at 5:45 to make sure everything is set up accordingly. And we're looking forward to each of you who are going to be here. Thank you to all of the pastors who are going to be here to receive that deposit on Tuesday night. And we look forward to hosting you. Yes, ladies will be in their black dresses. Yes, they will be in their black dresses. So thank you. If there's anything else that we need to know to be prepared, we want to be excellent. So thank you so much for preparing for Tuesday night's Game Changers. Level 2 Game Changers takes place, kicks off next Tuesday, April the 6th, from 7 p.m. to 8:45. So for those of you who did not get in on the first level, will be prepared for Level 2 Game Changers. Praise the Lord, you're in the hand of Pastor David at this time.
Amen.
Amen. Let's stand to our feet. Amen. We're going to stand to our feet. And so remember, Game Changers, and then Pastor Burns' birthday. Hallelujah. Welcome to all our first-time visitors. If you can wave your hand if you're a first-time visitor, we want to celebrate you. Hey there, young guys. Hey there, young guys. How you doing? First-time visitors. Make sure you see if you're good to go. Amen. We would like to greet you and to celebrate you and thank God for you being here. Also, again, through the word, thank you. 25 years of ministry, and the best is yet to come. Uncommon favor and uncommon situations. Then if there's somebody here that they realize, you know what, I need to be in a place like this that can give me the wisdom of God, the heart of God, the spirit of God, and even God himself. You can accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today. Yes. The Bible says this without a doubt, that if you believe in him, he now can save you and deliver you from whatever situation you're in. We have a God that will meet you right where you are. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God has raised him through the dead, you shall be saved. Yes. Through Jesus Christ. He can make you brand new today. I want to give my life to him. He's already given his life for us.
Yes.
The Bible says he commended his love for us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died.
Yes.
That's the measure of his love. He gave his life for your life. Now all we have to do is give our life for his. That's how much he loves us. You want to give your life to Christ, you can just pray it even now. Father, I ask you to come into my life and save me.
Yes.
Forgive me my sins and wash me and purge me. Renew me. I repent for my sins, and I actually come into me. Even today, Jesus, save me from all of my sins. I confess with my mouth, believe in my heart, that God has raised you from the dead. Through you, I am saved. Through faith, by grace, God. Even today, we accept you in Jesus' name. You prayed that prayer. Make sure you see it after service.
Yes.
God has welcomed you into the kingdom. Let's celebrate somebody into the kingdom. We celebrate God through you. We know that our very kingdom will be coming. Father, we pray to bless the people that come to this world. Bless them as they come and as they go. We declare and write out your word of their life. You preserve our going out and preserve our coming in. You will bless us from this time forth and forevermore. We decree it. We declare it. The blessing of the Lord make it rich and add no sorrow. We bless Apostle even now. We bless my dead even now. We thank you, Father God, for their team. Thank you, family, Father God. We speak blessings over them and favor over them. We give you the glory, the honor, and praise for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Celebrate somebody. Give somebody a hug. Break down, please. Thank you so much.